Catholic Charities of Santa Clara County has been involved in refugee work for over 40 years, starting with resettling some of the first Vietnamese refugees to becoming one of only three providers in California to care for unaccompanied refugee children. We have been on the front lines of caring for those who were forced to leave their homelands for decades. Now, in the face of yet several more global crises, we have answered the call to serve again and have most recently opened our doors to Afghans and other populations who are seeking safety here in the United States. Our work is not just about providing practical resources, though. We are also in the business of empathy building. When Saint Clare's Catholic School reached out to us to ask how they could help on their day of service, we went beyond the mere ask of just gathering donations. We asked them to participate in a refugee simulation, and their students rose to the occasion. Saint Clare's was uniquely positioned for this project. As part of their school mission, they seek to build thought leaders, social justice advocates, and compassionate humans. Led by a principal who encouraged them to move beyond a theoretical understanding of what it meant to be a refugee, we planned a day of service where 5th through 8th grade students and their parents could participate in this simulation. Younger students ranging in age from preschool to 4th grade were encouraged to attend a more age-appropriate activity led by one of our staff. Passages is a refugee simulation game developed by the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees in the 1990s. It consists of 7 to 10 modules, depending on the time given to complete the game. And it was designed to help people break xenophobic thinking and build empathy for refugees who are fleeing persecution, armed conflict, or more recently, unlivable climates. Young people are specifically targeted for this activity because it encourages activism and understanding in the next generation. Similarly, creating an experiential learning opportunity as a game allows participants to deepen their understanding of how and why people become refugees. Participants in the simulation experience difficult emotions and feel driven to take action to support refugees. We hoped that by hosting this experience, students would walk away with a greater understanding of the experiences that 27 million refugees experience annually. Students were also asked at the end of the simulation to participate in a call to action to serve the refugees that Catholic Charities of Santa Clara County is currently supporting. Before starting the game, our team set up the school with 2 distinct areas. Parent volunteers helped us to create temporary shelter and border crossing by using just a few basic materials like tables, chairs, string, old soda cans, bells, and tarps. The players were then welcomed into groups by families by using a method that ensured that they were with people that they didn't know. Then they were asked to familiarize themselves with their characters, their imaginary roles, and backgrounds.
Okay. Don't pull. All right, you two are in a family. Since you have the same one. You two are in a family. You two are in a family. Daniel?
Tom. I'm Tom. Okay, so he's a boy that's 17, and what does that say?
Farmhand.
Oh, you're a farmhand. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, what do you guys want to be?
Okay, you guys clear?
Yeah.
So we all got separated from our own actual families. Obviously a terrible situation. Mm-hmm. Our family members were killed rather violently.
So we have to eat what we can find. We have our traditional religion, but we only speak the dialect of where we are from.
Then we all speak different languages.
So we're speaking 3 different languages.
After familiarizing themselves with their roles, families listened to the sounds of the initial attack that made them decide to flee. A scenario was read out loud while the participants were blindfolded, which forced them to think through and use their imagination on how they might feel if this were a real life situation.
During a normal family outing to the center of your village, an airplane swoops low over the rooftops. The tremendous noise startles and frightens you. A few seconds later, a whole formation of airplanes appears in the distance and attacks the town. Participants were then told that they needed to run to the other side of the gym while still blindfolded and find their other family members. Some of their family members sustained injuries during the attack, which made fleeing harder for the entire family. This was meant to show how easy it is to get separated from loved ones when fleeing. Module 3 is called Emergency Supply Case, and it forces participants to think through what they would bring with them with an extremely limited amount of time. They had only a few minutes to decide what would be most important to them on the journey ahead as they left their country forever. After being forced to leave quickly, participants are then moved through the process of finding temporary shelter. Fleeing one's country rarely happens within the span of a day, and refugees are often forced to spend days and nights in inhospitable conditions that are fraught with fear and pain. Participants in this module get a feel for how scary and tiring this part of the journey can be. Eventually, for all refugees, they will be forced to make a decision on whether they should leave their country or not. The decision to leave is one that's filled with fear and sorrow and confusion. Participants in Module 5 are asked to think about this decision with their family members and decide if they should cross the border. Once families have decided to leave, they must cross a border which is often an unkind and physically challenging experience. Refugees must often also make a decision to go the safe way or the long way. And lastly, when they reach the border, refugees need to complete identification forms that are often not in their language with little to no assistance. This border is dangerous. There are two different ways that you can cross. This is a river. You must be careful crossing the river. There are two different ways to get across your border. One that is the fastest way, but the most dangerous. The second will take you longer, but it's safest. Choose wisely. If if you hit the bells or the cans, you are only allowed one time to hit the bell individually. If you hit the bell more than once, there may be a problem for you at the border.
Okay, picture. Left foot all the way up. Really high up. Really high.
Okay. I feel like that's...
Nope, it's okay. Keep going, just go straight, and I'll tell you when you need to really lay flat.
Okay. Yeah.
Where are your supplies? We'll be taking your gold, your map, and your first aid kit.
If refugees are allowed to cross the border into a new country, they're then forced to remain in refugee camps that provide the most basic aid available to keep them alive. Participants in this module get a feel for how harsh camp life can be. And this is how we concluded our simulation at St. Clare's. In our final debrief of the game, participants were asked to share more about what surprised them, what they learned.
It's really enlightening, and it helps us to like really understand the predicament of everyone else that goes through this, that all the refugees that have to like stay at refugee camps for like years at a time, they have to like be away from everything they've ever known. Whole new language, a whole new country, different people they've never seen before. It's really shaking.
I mean, how quickly, you know, our group, you know, decided to work together and do things, but I also knew this was going to end. So as hard as it was or how difficult it was for those few minutes, I know I would be able to go back to, you know, the life that I had. And I think that's why it really made me feel very empathetic, because it's like 5 years of this. I mean, how much hope can people have 5 years of hope?
Well, I was kind of like excited because I wanted to see like what it felt like because my parents immigrated to a country. So I kind of wanted to get a sense of that, like a feel. And also, I wanted to help, and I wanted other people to experience that too.
Something that surprised me particularly about today was, you know, how quick our participants were, you know, really in the game, in the situation.
Throughout the procedures and everything, we were bonded each other. So I kind of feeling that getting a new family.
I do feel motivated after this and inspired to continue to learn how I can become an advocate and an ally to refugees, and how I can support and use the privilege that I have to really create a better world.
This simulation was an effective and short way for participants to build empathy and understanding for refugees globally. We would love to bring this simulation to other schools and organizations to help bring more awareness to this population that is so deserving of support.